to the furtherance of the citizenship, self-centered citizenship, which is now gone. We're so selfish, nobody is doing anything for the good of others. I want to know what's in it for me. We are really in bad shape. You ought to read a new book by again, my age, senior moment. One Nation also wrote the book America the Beautiful. It's on TV all the time. The African American neurosurgeon who has become so involved.
Is it Ben Carson?
Any of you know what I'm talking about?
Is it Ben Carson?
Ben Carson. Ben Carson. Ben Carson. His book, One Nation, talks again about the need for being less argumentative, less partisan, and that we need to come together and think through. And we don't have to argue so much as dialogue and so on, because he is concerned, and many others are, that our nation is losing some of what it once had that they would create as we're in this best that we're in right now. And then the latest blow to Georgia football, Gurley has been suspended. Have you heard that?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, what happened? Flawing character, perhaps, I don't know. It's just awful. And he'll be facing Missouri tomorrow. But your understanding of yourself is the most important requirement in your efforts to influence kids to know themselves. Gain and help them. And if you don't know yourself well, you can't do much. Sidney Harris made this statement, talking about the authentic teacher. A person is either himself or herself, is either rooted in his existence or is a fabrication, has either found his humanhood or is still playing with masks and roles and status symbols. Only an authentic person can evoke a good response in the core of the other person. Only person is resonant to person. Knowledge is not enough. Technique is not enough. Mere experience is not enough. This ability is not possessed by those who have failed to come to terms with their own individual person, no matter what other talents they possess, until they have liberated themselves, not completely but mostly, from what is artificial and authentic within themselves. They cannot communicate with, counsel, and control others. As a student, you have often continued to play a role, and you've had trouble sometimes being yourself because you were caught up in following that role that was expected. But we hope in the cohort model, living together with your colleagues, you will come to a better understanding of yourself, which then will permit you to help others understand themselves. All has to do with relationships. Cognitive learning is hard won by someone whose life is in affective disarray. We push so hard to get these kids to do well on tests without taking time to get their personal lives in order or in claim, expecting them to do well in tests when some of them are carrying baggage with them every morning that simply does not permit them to do well on tests or to learn well. And yet we don't stop and realize that it takes time. It really bothers me. And this is a conviction, this next quote is a conviction that, though it really wasn't exclusively mine by any means, I first came across the notion based on the research of Kenneth Clark, who is a highly regarded researcher. But students underachieving is more the result of deficiencies in the heart than in the head. Students' self-perception is the cause of the underachievement rather than a lack of native or innate ability. We write kids off as low grades and so on. But that's really not the problem. Schools have been good at providing learned helplessness. Kids have learned they're deficient, not to do. And we assume that then they lack something in mind, but they don't. Isn't it amazing when you see what middle school kids can do in gymnastics, in athletics, in music? Gee, amazing. And yet in the classroom, sometimes they act like they can't do anything. Gee, skateboarding, anything. Lonnie Silver told me to practice. You've got to help kids to see and feel better about themselves. And you can do it. And in many respects, only you can do it. Because so much in their ongoing society has worked against it. But you know, you have the second and last chance. And that phrase has been used a lot in connection with turning points and other things. You can't overcome some things early like you'd like to. But here, when they reject the values that they've had and decide for themselves what they're doing, then you have this chance that Mother Nature provides. When you have this black open window. What time are we supposed to be over with?
Now. Now.
Now?
Yeah.
Oh. Well. Okay. I will share with you copies of these. But as these are being passed out, let me quickly make these comments. You better remember what teaching is. You arrive at school on election day wearing a little sticker that says, "I voted today." Are you teaching? You go to the ball on Saturday and you run into some of your kids and you stop and talk to them. Are you teaching? You go to the hospital Sunday afternoon and visit one of your students who is admitted in action. Are you teaching? Teaching is so much more than instructive, and yet that's what it's come to be meant. You stand beside a student who's working a math problem, and you watch him as he works, and then you squeeze him on the shoulder and walk away. Not a word was spoken. Were you teaching? You walk down the hallway with two students on the way to the student council meeting, will you share with them your views on some current issue that has to bear? Are you teaching? You stop by as you leave school and see a student in your class who you know is down and discouraged. And you stop and talk to him, and you bring up what you know is a home-related problem. Are you teaching? Teaching is so much more than what the public has come to think of it as instructive, giving directions. So it's this personal thing, and that's what really counts. The curriculum is what goes on when you close the classroom door. It's you that counts. Never underestimate your power, your influence. Go for it. Kids need you. Thank you.